something happening here.
In many instances, public art uses beauty as a false promise of inclusion. Beauty ameliorates the erasure of ethnic presence, serving the transformation into a homogenized visual culture. Give them something beautiful to stand in for the loss of the right to a public presence. Judith Baca. Art encompasses every aspect of our lives, a form of communication as old as humankind itself. Art is how humans have celebrated, recorded, and described our lives since the beginning of time. It's always been a central part of our humanity. For as important as art can be, it can also be problematic, recording a history that further discriminates against or ignores the Latinx and other marginalized communities. The mural Everyone Loves a Parade was installed in 2012 by Canadian artist Pierre Hardy in a wide alleyway off of Church Street in Burlington, Vermont. It is described as a history of Vermont, beginning in 1609 with the arrival of Samuel de Champlain. The artist purports that the mural is a depiction of Vermont's evolution over time, with a particular emphasis on Burlington. The mural presents a historical narrative of the 400 years that elapsed after De Champlain's arrival. At first glance, the Church Street Marketplace mural appears to be a jovial display of state pride illustrated through a parade of famous Vermonters past and present. There are 93 identified important historical figures, ranging from De Champlain to Golf Hall of Fame inductee Patty Sheehan. Mary Coffey, Associate Professor of Art History at Dartmouth, said in a 2010 article in The Dartmouth, "In public art controversy, the art in question is almost always the occasion for voicing other grievances. For example, when attacking colonial legacies of racial inequality seem impossible, the easier and at times more productive thing to do is criticize a work of public art and demand some form of public representation that would symbolically rectify what otherwise seems politically or economically intractable." This phenomenon can be seen in the current public response in Burlington over the Church Street Marketplace mural. Once looking critically at the mural, however, it is easy to understand why it has become controversial in the years following its installation. What at first appears to be a parade for a glorious occasion, the mural becomes problematic when, upon further examination, you notice that the people on every panel are almost entirely white. This overrepresentation of the white population, coupled with the blatant disregard for Vermont's rich cultural history, has made the mural a source of controversy. This controversy came to a head when, in January of 2018, Burlington activist Albert Petrarca spray-painted "Off the Wall" on the mural to indicate public discontent and draw attention to the racial undertones that are presented. Petrarca isn't alone, however, in his protests, as the "Off the Wall" movement has formed around removing the whitewashed mural and replacing it with a mural that includes people of color. In the following clip, Petrarca explains why he finds the mural so offensive.
Really take another look at it, because we do think that it's undeniably a white supremacist mural. It completely obliterates the over 12,000 years of First Nation civilization history.
Similar comments have been made in the Facebook group, such as the following: "I see the mural as representative of the racist structure of our society, both in our country and right here in Vermont. I see the mural as supporting white people's blindness to, legacy of, and continued contribution to a racist system. When those two aspects of the mural are combined, the mural then becomes permission for our racist structure to continue. That is not okay on any level, and it's why I request the mural be removed immediately. As a city, we have a choice to make. Do we condone racism, or do we work to undo it? It's one or the other. Let's get real about racism, and as a city, start to undo it. We condone it, or we undo it."
The issues with the mural stem largely from the aforementioned lack of representation for Latinx people, African Americans, and Native Americans. Above all, this mural is a whitewashing of Vermont's history. One of the chief arguments from supporters of the mural, however, is that the issue lies not with the mural itself, but with Vermont's demographics. In an interview, Pierre Hardy said, "The abundance of white faces on the mural is merely a reflection of Vermont's demographics. If the mural is so white, so is 2010 Vermont." Although Vermont has been described as one of the whitest states in the country, as 91% of the population is white, Hardy's defense is problematic and falls short in numerous ways. Of the 93 identified figures, only one is black and none are Latinx, Native, or Asian. Of the nearly 100 people who are not identified in the mural, only one is black and another indigenous person is in stereotypical Native American clothing. Burlington is more diverse than Vermont as a whole and home to the University of Vermont, which has a more diverse population than the town census accounts for. If the mural were to be representative of 2010 Vermont, as the artist said, we ask why out of 200 people, not a single Latinx person is depicted. This lack of minority figures is even more problematic given that the mural includes images of individuals with no association to Vermont, most notably Elvis Presley and Mona Lisa. If the artist was willing to include famous figures or artwork with no connection to Burlington or Vermont, it is even more curious that he did not choose to include more than a couple non-white figures. Why did he not include Julia Alvarez, a Dominican-American writer who graduated summa cum laude at Middlebury College in 1971? Julia Alvarez has called Vermont her home since 1988, when she returned to Middlebury and is currently the writer-in-residence at Middlebury College. In 2014, Alvarez received the National Medal of Arts, which is the highest honor conferred to individual artists by the people in the United States. She is certainly more distinguished than many of the white men Hardy chose to include and more connected to Vermont than Elvis or Mona Lisa. The whitewashing in Everybody Loves a Parade perpetuates the invisibility that people of color have faced for centuries. When public art only acknowledges and highlights white men, it furthers this invisibility and causes people like Hardy to believe that Vermont is so white. It makes it easy for people like Hardy to, in the future, look only to white men and easily ignore the diversity that exists even in Vermont. One of the panels depicting Champlain's arrival in Vermont paints an exceedingly white portrait of events. The Native American shown is portrayed in a diminutive, submissive way that belittles the importance of indigenous peoples in Vermont and their contributions to society. The failure to recognize the Native individual further diminishes and ignores the long history of indigenous populations in Vermont. This panel thus preserves white hegemonic narratives and perpetuates the historical inaccuracies of the mural. This panel is one example of a paid advertisement for local businesses. While Hardy did not choose who paid for a spot on the mural, the influence of white business owners is evident. Allowing paid content to determine certain elements of artwork gives individuals and business owners the power to push designs out of their own self-interest and further enforces the status quo. Orozco's Epic of American Civilization is the most prominent example of public art at Dartmouth and has been met with fierce criticism over the years. While students and faculty alike supported Orozco during its creation, alumni at the time called for its removal, oftentimes without ever having seen it, but disproving nonetheless because it did not uphold the ideals of the Dartmouth student. Surprisingly, as recent as 2010, an op-ed in the Dartmouth criticized the murals as imposing their presence on people that did not come to see them and claiming that the college is biased toward unpopular opinions. In a response piece the next day, Mary Coffey tears the author's argument apart point by point and explains how damaging assuming a single value system for an entire community can be, especially at such a multicultural place as Dartmouth. Painted by Walter Beach Humphrey only 3 years after the creation of the Orozco murals, the Hovey murals illustrate a white depiction of events that trivializes the contributions made by minority groups. The murals found in the basement of 53 Commons are painted with extensive racial undertones that belittle indigenous peoples. This mural appealed to the predominantly white male population of Dartmouth at the time, but as demographics have shifted, perceptions of the mural have also changed and, as a result, it is no longer a dining hall. Migrant workers are fundamentally crucial to the survival of farms in Vermont and New Hampshire.
Well, I think farmers, if you talk to them, are really aware that they need this help because most farmers can't afford to hire workers from the United States where they have to pay, you know, have to worry about health insurance or certain hours or when people are available. And these migrant workers that have come here, they want to work as much as possible because really what they want to do is earn enough money to be able to go back, be able to give their families a good life there. So they'll work 24/7, 365 days a year. They need that income. So I think the farming community really knows that these people are carrying the farming, the whole sustainability of our farms on their backs. They really are necessary.
Yet, Latinx workers are nowhere to be seen in the Lebanon Post Office mural. The mural has only one man, a farmer and his two horses plowing a field. Perhaps because it is only one man, lack of Latinx representation in the mural hasn't garnered controversy or resulted in public backlash on the scale of Everyone Loves a Parade. The mural is, however, emblematic of the Latinx community's erasure from local artwork and history. The mural ignores the importance of migrant workers and contributes to the whitewashing of local culture and history. Ultimately, the intention of public art is to promote inclusivity in the community and commemorate a community's vision of their history and recollection of historical events. The whitewashing of the Church Street Marketplace mural does a disservice to Vermont's minority communities and silences their voices. This issue of underrepresentation extends beyond Burlington. Only by pressuring legislators and actively promoting and incorporating the narratives of minority communities in public forums will we be able to deconstruct hegemonic views within our society. As an artist, I have always tried to be faithful to my vision of life, and I have frequently been in conflict with those who wanted me to paint not what I saw, but what they wished me to see. Feeling so good, change the colors to my phone. Orange Kool-Aid, go good with Patron. Oh no, hell no, boy. We steal my ringtone, free car wash. Had to clean up the Dodge. Give back when I can, just playing my part. Church folks had a fish fry, mustard, hot sauce, light bread, french fries. Love for the big guy, hit the park. Boys showing off their hot, nappy roots on the radio. And you know what about last night?